It's a memory of a very proud time. Of course, we were all very happy to see it succeed. It had been alive in our minds for many years before that date, and we were internally were prepared to see it come off, but we were not quite sure whether it would succeed. So we were under tension, of course, but it was a tension full of optimism and full of faith in the success. My wife and I were invited to come down to the Cape and be on the grandstand, and we were also asked, my wife and I, to take care of a famous visitor, Professor Oberth, and his wife. They came from Germany, and of course for Professor Oberth, who had predicted in his vision the lunar flight for many years. Actually, I would say for about 40 or 50 years, it was a particularly proud and happy moment. It was a gigantic program, of course, and the management problems were extremely large and oftentimes seemed overwhelming. Fortunately, there were some circumstances which were very helpful. The fact that our president was very much behind it. So was the vice president, and Congress was behind the project, even the Bureau of the Budget. It was a dream come true, and every one of us was extremely happy, of course, first when the astronauts landed, and even more so when they landed back on Earth, because that was then the completed and fulfilled dream. Dr. von Braun was an extremely unusual person. In fact, he was a genius in 5 or 6 different fields at the same time. First, I would name his visionary foresight and his creative mind that he had in everything he did and wanted to do. He began to dream about the moon and about travel into space when he was about 13 or 14 years old, and that dream never left him. He lived up to it up to his very end. Second, he was a superb engineer, not for the smaller things like fixing water faucets around the house and things of that kind, but he was a brilliant engineer when it came to building rockets and spacecraft and the manifold systems that are needed to make them successful. He was furthermore very good at presenting and promoting his ideas to the powerful people in our government. And that went up to the president himself, to the vice president, to the people in Congress, the people in the Bureau of the Budget, to the Defense Department. He understood to approach them, to incite their interest in space and to realize that work for the space program is something of great importance, not only for the technicians, but also for the politicians and for those who are responsible for the well-being of our nation. Second, he was equally good at promoting his ideas of space flight with the public. He wrote and published about 500 articles during his lifetime about technical and scientific aspects and about the great importance and meaning of space flight and space exploration for our civilization in general. He was very good at that. He could charm any audience, and he did so. He talked not only to engineers and scientists, he talked to lawyers, to real estate people, even to people interested in sports, and to a wide cross-section of the public. And he did that very successfully. Then furthermore, he was an extremely successful team builder, and he managed to maintain his team from the very beginning. That was back in about 1932 when he started out with building up his team. And the stability, his team grew enormously, of course, over the years, particularly in this country. And the team that he built around himself was of an unusual stability. In fact, by the time he had to leave the team in Huntsville in 1970, the German group was still almost intact as it had been through many, many years. It was a privilege to work for him. Everybody who was in his team was happy and proud to work with and for him. He was a tough taskmaster, there's no doubt about that, and he demanded the utmost from his co-workers, but it was given happily even, and everyone who worked for him and with him had the feeling that he did and could do better work because he worked for Van Braun. Of course, it is easily understandable that he did not much have time for anything because it was so many things that in which he was continuously involved. But he had a few rules for himself which helped him very much in achieving what he did and in saving and having the time for those things which were important to him. For example, he said he would never spend and waste time in grieving about things which he cannot change. He said, when I am confronted with something which is really bad, I simply ask myself, can I do something about it to better it? If I can, I do it. If I cannot, I push it out of my mind because it would be lost time. Second, he worked fast. He worked quickly and efficiently. And third, he worked with his mind continuously. In the car, when he went up and down in the elevator, his mind was continuously at work. On the other hand, he also understood to take off once in a while. On weekends, when he was in town, he spent time with his family. He had two or three boats on the river in Tennessee. I remember very well at the beginning when we arrived in Huntsville, that was in the early 50s, he was the one who pioneered water skiing on the Tennessee. By that time it began, and all of a sudden many people water skied. Then he was a very avid scuba diver, and I think he dove in all the warm oceans around the globe at one time or another. But still, he had a lot of time for the work he was supposed to do, and he did so brilliantly, namely building rockets and spacecraft. I remember that very often when there was a new project to be discussed, he came to the meeting with his technical people and talked about it, and it became evident immediately that in his own time, perhaps at night, perhaps early in the morning or late at night, he had done all his homework. He was completely familiar with the problems involved. He could ask the right questions. He could ask all of the questions that had to be asked. And so his work alone and with his team members was always extremely efficient and successful. In fact, he was always full of jokes, and there was hardly a meeting, and particularly in social meetings, when he did not tell stories. One thing is very interesting to note. His secretary of 25 years, Bonnie Holmes, told us that story one day. She said, sometimes Van Braun has to hold a meeting with unpleasant problems. And the people came into the meeting. I saw them going into the room, and their heads were low, and they had sinister attitudes and didn't talk much. And then they went in, and then Van Braun went in, and it didn't take longer than 5 minutes when a loud laughter was coming from that room, and then I knew Van Braun had again made another joke and had brightened the minds up. At the time when the Apollo program came to its final test, there were other events in our country and on the earth that weighed heavily on the minds of many people: Vietnam, racial unrest, and others. We hoped that with our project, with the Luna project, if it were successful, we could help to divert to some extent the depressing thoughts on many minds. And we hoped that we could show that there is really a future for mankind, and particularly for our technology, for our work, for the exploration of space. And it was more than seeing eye to eye. Kennedy visited our center here, and he received, of course, a royal tour through our test stands. The two of them were happy as young boys. They were sitting in that car. I saw them drive by, and they were laughing at each other and talking. They were just like young boys who were very happy together. And von Braun told us later that when they drove through the arsenal, and, through the Marshall Center, and von Braun could show him the facilities we have here from the outside and some from the inside, Kennedy said, "Well, for heaven's sake, I wish I could take my congressional members through this, then they would get a different attitude towards the space program." The Disney story was preceded by the publications in the Collier's magazine, and these were very successful in concentrating the interest of the people on space and on space flight. The Disney people heard about it, and the fact is that one of Disney's people, Ward Kimball, he said to Disney, "I just read these articles in the Collier Journal, and they really got me interested. I think that's something we should put into our own program." And Disney asked him then to make a little plan and the outlay of what he had in mind. Kimball did, and Disney was immediately very much interested. From this point, the three programs developed that Disney did with von Braun. They went over very well as movies. And then one of Eisenhower's men, called Disney and said, "Please send me a copy of your film." Disney did. Eisenhower showed it to his cabinet members and his staff, and I don't know to whom else. Anyway, it seems to have impressed people. And then not long after that, Eisenhower made the decision to establish NASA and to develop space as a national undertaking. One of the Disney people then said, "Hey, that shows that Eisenhower was became interested because of our movie." Von Braun heard about that, and he immediately wrote a letter to Disney and said, "For heaven's sake, don't say that. It would be wrong. It would be counterproductive, and please do not say that." The decision by Eisenhower to develop space further is Eisenhower's decision, and he is not influenced and need not be influenced by people like us here. And please do not say that. And Disney understood fully and left it out. The main reason why the management of this huge program, which involved about 400,000 people at the peak of the program, the reason why this could be managed and did function so well was the existence of one person, that was Mr. Jim Webb. Webb was nominated by President Kennedy and asked by President Kennedy to become the administrator for NASA. He did. It's interesting to note that Webb said, "Mr. President, if you want me to, I'll be glad to, but under one condition: I work for you. I don't work for the Bureau of the Budget or for Congress or for the Vice President. I work for you. If we can agree on that, I will do it." Well, both people agreed, and Webb did an excellent job, a brilliant job. Without him and without his superior management capabilities, the thing would not have happened and not succeeded in this form. There were a number of plans. Von Braun had his plans, which were more or less set out years before. And they were modified slightly in the course of time, but not too much. And what von Braun wanted to do after the Apollo flight was to go on with the space station and then with the Mars flight, expedition to Mars. And at the same time with more exploration of the moon, and in between unmanned flights to further out in the solar system to the planets. That was roughly what he wanted to do. And he still began to some extent on that program in the form of Skylab. Skylab became our first station in space. You may remember that there were three crews of three people, three astronauts each, and they together spent several months in orbit. It was a very, very successful project. Unfortunately, it was terminated after the first flight, which was very unfortunate. On the other hand, von Braun, he was always looking far in the future, but at the same time with a lot of realism. He had the hand on the pulse, so to speak, of the people and of the government particularly, and he realized also the problems. And I remember him saying at one time, or several times, well, one of the problems is that we ran out of moons. That means simply we don't have a relatively easy target close by which can fire up everybody in the government and among the people. Mars is still a couple of years ago away, and particularly a few hundred thousand miles away. So it will not be so easy to get the same support for an early Mars project as we could get it for the moon. But in general, he said, what we have to do is to keep up our good work, to make sure that we don't have any technical mishap, and we have to make sure that we keep the public interested and that we keep good relationships with our colleagues in Houston and in the other NASA centers and at the Cape,